Yeah, we had to have church every day out in the week. Some of us just wouldn't make it.
Amen.
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 But for the meal site, we just don't want to praise in the 2 hours we're here. We'll look down the road and see if somebody else praises. Or we see if somebody else lifting their hands. But they didn't wake you up this morning. They didn't watch over you last week. They didn't protect you. Driving over the airways and the highways. And the meal site that you woke up early this morning, your mind stayed on Jesus. It's enough to praise him for. Y'all ain't talking to me. You got to understand the problem. Number one, we holler about our generation. They don't see us praising. Huh? And if they don't see you praising, why would we praise? Amen. The Spirit of Christ, I ain't gonna fuss this moment. The Spirit is too high. And there is a praise in the building. And so the Spirit fussing, I'm gonna teach you how to praise Him. Amen. Amen. Again, we honor the Spirit of Christ and to all our colleagues in the ministries. Thank you again for ready for all that you do and all that you continue to do in prayer and strength to the ministry. Again, I thank God for our officers, members and friends, and to my wife who's here on this morning and serving. I'm always delighted that when my mama can come back. Amen. One of the strongest persons in my life.
Amen.
And I see her as a female. My mom.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Because when I break down, I pick up the phone and call mom.
Amen.
Everybody got to have somebody.
That's right.
Amen.
And I'm 55 years old. When the pressure gets unbearable, sometimes I can't call y'all because as soon as I finish talking to you, tell somebody, you know who called me? Know where he's going? Huh? Amen. I'm going to move on, but I'm just going to tell you the kind of mom I have. The whole time yesterday that I was sitting here, before I stood up, she was praying. In her seat. We didn't have to make contact, but I could just feel her prayer. Look over and go. Anoint him, Lord. Touch him, Lord. Give him strength, Lord. Y'all ain't talking to me. Bible says the prayers of the righteous avail much. It's in those moments in time that after I finish, went back to the fellowship hall. And the reality of the load came off of me. I kneel down in front of her. I said, Mama, rub my head.
Praise God. Praise
and tell me everything is going to be all right. Why do you say that in front of us? Because I don't want y'all to see a make-believe person. All of my help comes from the Lord. I go through and suffer just like you go through and suffer. But God has placed people around me to strengthen me when I'm going through. And so I'm grateful. This moment, as I continue to look at the program, I'm amazed how God kept me in ministry for 35 years. 22 years here. And before I got here, I took Bibles, I told him, briefcases.
Amen.
I sit on podiums but didn't get a chance to open my mouth. I sit with preachers. But while you sit in the room, you didn't have nothing to say because you were too young. So all you could do was just listen. I sit until due time came. But I was faithful to my pastor. 25 years, I never asked any preacher, will you allow me to preach?
All right, now, Pastor.
The Bible said your gift will make me. But we're living in a different day now. They do their trial sermon today and tomorrow they bishops. They want to be all that in a bag of chips. But the truth be told is a humbling experience. Because you can be up today and lose it all tomorrow. But you won't lose God. So thank you. I'm grateful. The year goes by. I look at the mere fact. I thank God. No, I didn't fall 17. Didn't die every hour. Yes, I had some problems. But the Lord dealt with me and my problems. That's right. I can see a person in one step, but then I can look down the road and see where they could be. You as members, you can't always see the person in the state that they are in. You need to look beyond their faults and see that one day God can clean you up, he can clean them up. Huh? You ain't always came in here on Sunday morning. Truth be told, you ain't always came in here without liquor on your breath. When you two sit where they're sitting right now. So just throw your arms around in moments of time. I'm going to move on, but I'm going to tell you the changing part of my ministry. Boss, before I came here, I got out of ministry because I took and saw everything to heart. I backseat. Gave up the Bibles. Gave up the books and turned in the roads. And one of the preachers that I ran revival for came by the house. I ducked him. He said, tell him I've been by here. Waited 2 weeks later. I went over to his house. I said, go ahead and beat me down. I know you're going to talk about me. I'm out there. He said, no, that ain't what I came over your house for.
Go ahead, go ahead.
He said, I came over your house to let you know if you don't never run a revival.
All right.
If you don't ever preach again. He said, I've come to tell you that I love you.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I threw his arms around.
All right.
I wasn't expecting that. I was expecting to be beat up. I was expecting to be told, I told you so. Huh? But when he threw his arms around, my hands with him, saying, what must I do to be saved? He got back in ministry. And from that point on, God has been blessing me. I had to shed it because somebody stumbles along the way sometimes. If you ain't careful, the devil will keep you in your stomach. But I don't care how dirty you are, you just get up. Get the dirt off you. Get back on the horse. And ride it for him. God will bless you. Yes, he will. I didn't get up to say all that, but sometimes y'all look at preachers. You thank the call for watches, the suit, maybe where they live, maybe where they drive. You see and believe that they got it going. But you don't see the attack from the end. You don't see the suffering. You don't see the pain. What you see is things. Things don't make ministry. You put the kingdom of God first. And these things shall be added unto you. Don't get in it for the thing. The things shall pass away. But you get in for what the Lord gives you. And he will bless you. I don't care what ministry you serve in church. You be faithful.
Yes.
If don't nobody come but you. You be faithful. If don't nobody want to hear nobody but you. You be faithful. And God promised you because of your faithfulness. I'm going to change. He said, I'm going to bless you because you're so smart. Oh, you got it going on. Oh, everybody know who you are. He said, because of your faithfulness. That's why we're blessed. In the book of Psalms. Just looking back. Sometimes, before you go forward, just look back. You don't have to go look back to the point you want to go back. No, you look back so you can see where he brought you from. He don't ever want you to look back so you go back. He just wants you to look back to see that you didn't bring you to where you are right now. Can you just for a moment just look back? And while you're looking back, just say, Lord, I just want to. I just want to meditate on how you brought me from death doors. How you saved me in spite of me. Thank you, Lord. Psalm. Praise him. Praise him. Yes. Yeah. God is in you. And when he show up like this, all you need is praise him. And let him have his way. I know you ain't never released yourself, but he's here. You don't have to be ashamed. Just let go. And let the Lord. But we're going to, year 2016, we're going to get to the point that I don't want y'all to be programmed. And every Sunday I stand up here, y'all think I'm going to deliver the word. But when the Spirit gets high, when the Lord sits down, with the common glory, shows up. That you thought must take place. perfection is filled with praise.
Amen.
I know we are used to certain protocols.
My God, my God.
That ain't what the scriptures say.
Thank you.
While Paul was preaching, they were still praising.
Amen.
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 We still be praising. Just for a few moments. I want to call your attention to the gospel. Psalms 8, verse 1 and 2. Amen. I said that because I didn't want anybody to say that you ever cut somebody off. Please. No. I understand. We can continue to praise God's speech. We've seen so much down through the years. And we get to the point that everything has to be protocol. What you saying?
Worship,
everything is religious.
Worship,
but it don't have nothing to do with God.
Yes.
And so when God show up, we want to tell God how long to stay.
Yes.
And what to do while he's here.
Yes.
But you must realize it's his house.
My God. Yes.
How you gonna come in and take over somebody else's house and tell them how long to stay and what to do in their house? Am I right about it? And so for years, we had moments in time we look at our wants. I know it's getting closer to one, but God is in his house. Amen. God knows today I'm not going to release you until he says so. And you walk out. That was a sermon I did years ago, even before the benediction. So you walk out, you can be hard-headed all you want. Okay. But surely, where you're going and what you got to do ain't no more important than the presence of God Almighty. Psalms 8 says, verse 1 and 2, and I'm not going to be before you long because I'm not going to allow the Spirit to drop down that low. But I preach, I'm going to encourage you.
Amen.
I'll come back at a later date and totally teach. But today, I need to get you where the Lord wants you to be.
Amen.
Amen. O Lord, how excellent is thy name, all the earth, who has set the glory above the heavens. And out of the mouth of babes and sucklings has thou ordained strength because of thy end, that thou mightest steal the enemy and the avenger. Reach over and just lightly touch the neighbor and say, neighbor,
there's power in prayer.
There's power in prayer. Huh? You see how God had already set this up? You see how everything is divine? Every time I try to go somewhere else this morning, God will take you. Huh? Power in praise. Beloved, have you ever wondered why when a baby enters the world, the first thing they do is cry? Oftentimes you recognize the mere fact that their crying is on the point where they're slapped on their behind and now they're entered to the world, but most of it is not because of the slap. Their crying is the point that they identify and cries out to God, even at an early stage, that I'm here, Lord. And because I'm here, I've got an obligation to praise you. Even at that stage, before a baby can talk, before they can walk, the first thing they do is develop a praise.
Oh my God.
Their praise is the holler, it's the cry, to let God know I'm appreciative just for being in the world. I knew you thought it was the slap, but you got to understand, way in the fetus, the baby still can hear and understand things before they're delivered in the world. And so for that reason, oftentimes, we fail to realize that how valuable it is to instill, especially young people, how to praise. When we're losing a generation for the mere fact that they're raised up without a God. They don't really know God because, and I'm not disrespecting anybody, but most households don't open up now with a praise. They don't open up with a prayer. They don't open up with acknowledgments to God. And for that reason, young people are now coming into a generation that they really don't know God. As I talk on a daily basis, as I talk to people, I'm blessed because I'm 55. Being 55, my mom is 72, 73. But that era of the baby boom, it's now that the generation behind me is a gap. Mm-hmm. It is a gap because they're not demanding them to come to Sunday school. It's a gap that is not demanding for the mere fact that they were instructed to sit in worship service. You can sit there for the mere fact, not all the time that you wanted to be there, but you was made to be there because praise and worship fell upon you. At that moment, you watch others praise God. You watch people throw up their hands, and totally you didn't understand what was going on, but you sit there until one day something fell upon you. Now, beloved, we ask them, do you want to come to church? Instead of letting them know, as for me in my house, everybody is going to church. Now, if I participated along with you all the week, if I provided a roof over your head, if I fed you, if I gave you lunch money, if I provided gas for your car, if I let you go to the football game, if I let you hang out with your friends, if I gave you a cell phone and paid the note, then beloved, 2 hours a week you owe me and the Lord. For the mere fact that it ain't about am I asking you, I'm commanding you to come for the mere fact of appreciation to the God that I recognize that provide these things. What we need to do, beloved, is develop a power of praise. When you develop a praise, you now praise God because there is a relationship. Now, when you develop a praise, what it means that I'm in rehearsal. Have you ever been to praise and rehearsal? There's a group of people that stands across the front with microphones, and they there primarily because of their voice. But real praise and worship is not predicated on your voice. I know you're going to pick the best 5 or 6 out of the group, and you want to export them across the front, and you now want to use them as part of praise and worship. But because I don't carry the E flat or F in the right note, you don't want me there. But you don't know what's on the inside. I'd rather have 5 people across the front that's sincere with praise and really can't get a note across, but they're sincere with praise. And then have 5 across the front, and it's all about them. You do understand that praise developed on the inside, and I'm praising him for who he is, what he's done. Once I develop a relationship in praise, I now can move to worship. The reason we don't understand worship, you have to be saved to worship. But you don't have to be saved to praise him. David says that everything that has breath, praise ye the Lord. He now goes back and signifies that not only do you praise him with your mouth, he said, but those that are on the drum, praise him with the top hits of the cymbals. That's the high cymbals. He said, praise him with the low hit. That's the foot cymbals. Then he says, praise him on the organ string. He now says that everything that has breath, praise God. What David signified, there are going to be moments in time, because David was, I feel like preaching. He was a chief musician. David knew that moments in time that even the musician gets happy. Are y'all going to understand that? What you mean that after the choir sit down, finish singing their song, sometimes they just can't cut off the organ. Sometimes you just can't stop beating the drum because it makes them happy. Am I right about that? And so what we got to understand, the power in praise, is that when the praise is developed in worship service, we don't need to focus on the program all the time. I know you up there, but you don't see something different this morning. But for the mere fact, Gloria got up, and Gloria really is quiet tone, but y'all didn't understand that when she said, you don't have to stop. right now. What Gloria experienced was that same praise that if the rocks can cry out, and before I let the rocks cry out, I'm going to praise him. You got to understand, God will use whoever he wants to use at the time that he wants to use them. Y'all let him talk to them. When she got to that point, it won't in her mind to tell you to praise him, but her spirit recognized the power of so y'all let him talking to me in here. And so the mere fact there's power in praise. What you mean, Reverend? I really don't have to have what is called protocol. You may put up your hands. I may get my feet. I may move from side to side. You may mumble. You may something. But every now and then, all of us ought to be able to say, thank you, Lord. Every now and then, somebody ought to declare hallelujah. I ought not be so stiff that I just can't open my mouth in the presence of God himself. It ain't about me sitting there and being all this, but every now and then my hands ought to just slip up. It doesn't matter if I'm saying that, but the mere fact that when I look back over what I could have went to and what the doctors could have diagnosed, but somehow God worked it out. What the psalmist said, a praise ought to go up. Well, when I didn't realize that my light bill was going to be paid, and all of a sudden somebody called me and said, Reverend, there's a fund that the Vepco company got, and you qualify, and so what? This month your wife is going to be paid for. A praise. Oh, just y'all ain't talking to me. Look back and see where he bought you from. And you get down to the gas pump and you pull out your money. Somebody said, you know what? I'm going to fill up the tank just for you. That's when a praise ought to go up. But for the power in praise and the realizing that we don't have a generation, and I don't blame the young people. I'm not here to criticize the young people, but you do know who I blame. I blame the baby boomers. The one that came along in my generation, because my children came to church every Sunday, whether they want to come or not. They sit here. He sit when he played the drum. He sit when he messed up in school and didn't play the drum. You will sit here anyway. Am I right? Part of your punishment is just to sit here and watch everybody else worship. Well, you got to understand two things happen if they sit long enough. They get mad and they get grown and they leave and promise they ain't coming back to church no more. But if they sit long enough, then they'll develop a praise and come every Sunday. You got to let them praise until the madness get out. They don't drive down here now because of me. They drive down here the mere fact because they want to praise and worship God. And so what you got to understand, beloved, the power in praise. First of all, most of us got is what I call a microwave praise. That's the shortest praise that you can give God. And the mere fact that we think we're doing God a favor just by saying something every now and then. You know how somebody can give you something and then now we don't even want to open our mouth and say thank you. And she just blessed me and all of us say thank you. No. You didn't have anything, and now all of a sudden somebody bless you with something. You didn't go declare thank you. No. It ought to be thank you. I really appreciate what you've done for me. But you act like they had to do what they did, and you act the same way towards God. And I've never seen a time where you can bless your children, you can give them something, and they ain't got time to pick up the phone and tell you thank you. Something is wrong somewhere. I don't care how many texts you sending out. Don't text me, baby. Pick up the phone. I got a problem with that. Y'all ain't understand. But for the mere fact that you ain't had it, and all of a sudden I send you something, and you ain't got the audacity to pick up the phone and tell me thank you. Well, I just want you to let mama, you tell, no mama, don't you tell me nothing. Let them call me themselves and tell me thank you for themselves. You don't understand, they schedule is so busy. I was so busy when they were so broke. And y'all sitting here and letting them get away with this mess. They text everybody else, you paying for the phone that they in Texas, bro, and they can't pick up the phone and call you and pray. Oh, I pray. You to know who's sick. But the same way we are to God, as much as he bless us, we got nerve to give him a 15-second prayer. Lord, first of all, I'll be here this morning, but you don't understand. I didn't really want to be here, so why did you come? Huh? If you didn't want to be here, you know where is a place of worship. You know what we come to lift up. Don't sit here and act like you're doing Reverend Boone a favor by showing up. If you didn't come to sing and you in the choir, sit down. If you didn't come to usher and you standing around the wall, sit down. Because you ain't doing me a favor. You can praise him while you're ushering. You can praise him while you're in the choir. You can praise him for the mere fact of what he does. So when you walk in the choir box, there ought to be a praise on your lips. Lord, I just want to thank you for where you brought me. I want to thank you for how you taught me. Microwave don't mean it's going to be fast. It don't mean it's going to be quick. It's not calibrated on how fast you do it. We're going to everything so fast that we're messing up something we need to just take out and just say, Lord, I just want to marinate. Jeremiah made up in his mind that I'm not going to say anything because I'm going to shut up. Jeremiah got the move and got the wig. He said, I got something down on the inside. That just won't let me hold. Might be dry because the person is beside is dry. Two dry people gonna make dry results. But just check out who the hell you are. That's the basis. Are you dry? Because I come by this moment to worship my Savior as he calls and he lives. I can face tomorrow. I'm going to my feet. But the third point I want to bring about is you ought to have a spirit of gratitude. That means that God don't owe me anything. And the mere fact that he blessed me, I'm going to say thank you. But I'm gratitude and grateful for the fact that he saved me. I was a wretch undone, but he looked beyond my fault and saw my need. If you woke up early this morning and looked at the daily light and saw that your name when you roll down the road and look over to the graveyard.
Yeah.